That's fine. Yes, सुविधा में चोरी.
Thank you, sir. तो एक दुविधा में हूँ. हमारे मतलब लीडर ऑफ द हाउस जिस तरीके की जवाब जो दे चुके हैं गुलाम नबी साहब को और लीडर ऑफ द अपोजिशन को और बाकी सवाल उठाए, अब उसका जवाब दूं तो असली मुद्दे जो है वो रह जाएंगे पीछे. अगर उसको बिना जवाब दिए हम जो है चुप भी नहीं रह सकते. लेट्स टेक दिस लैंड एक्विजिशन बिल सर. द मेनी पॉइंट्स दैट द लीडर ऑफ द हाउस हैज मेड टुडे विच शुड हैव बीन डिबेटेड प्रॉपरली एंड कंसिडर्ड. But the parliamentary standing committee which considered this bill in detail examined it, and the chairperson of that committee is the speaker of the other house today. This Sumitra Mahajan chaired committee. Let me read out some of the last points that he made. What does it say? This is the report, sir. The bill defines one of the recommendations. The bill defines infrastructure projects to include projects relating to generation of electricity, telecommunications, roads, services, highways, water supply, and other projects may be notified by the government. The committee feel that the bill gives a wide discretion to the government in notifying any project as infrastructure project, and this clause should be deleted. A committee headed by them. We moved amendments. They supported us then. And this is the charge, sir, that I have always been making standing from here. Whether my leader of the house was the leader of the opposition there, and whether the leader of the opposition today was part of the government then, we standing from here have always opposed those things which we consider to be anti-people and anti-economy and anti-country. We'll continue to do that. Because what does the same recommendation say, sir? He was talking about exemptions. What does that recommendation say? I'm quoting. The bill exempted 16 existing legislations. At that time it was 16, reduced to 13. 16 existing legislations that provide for land acquisition. The committee recommended that no central act should be exempted from the provisions of this bill, and necessary amendments should be brought in those acts to bring them on par with this bill. Committee recommended no exemptions. Now you are extending the list of exemptions. And in those that you have added in the list of exemptions are private educational institutions and private hospitals. I can go on. It's all there on the website and all these recommendations. What the Honorable Leader of the House today says has been negated by a committee headed by the Speaker of the other House today, Honorable Speaker, who then and today as a member of the ruling BJP were the one who recommended all this. Now this fight between Thuthu Maimai between them, the net result is that the country is losing. Honorable leader, I'm sure he's got very important business to attend, therefore he's leaving. therefore he's leaving. But anyway, I would only thank you before you leave for giving us a glimpse at what the budget will contain. you have told us what you're going to do, and that in itself, that's up to the government to decide whether it is actually a violation of the prerogative of the finance ministry or the cabinet. But let them listen. There are many issues that have been raised that require to be taken up seriously and answered. He said no scams in the first 9 months. In the first 5 years of the UPA 1, in the UPA 1 government, there were no scams.
There were all the scams.
No, hang on. Correct. So now, I agree with the Honorable Minister. I agree with the Honorable Minister that they were, sir, I agree with the Honorable Minister that these scams were cooking under UPA 1. They got exposed under UPA 2. Now, what are already cooking in these 9 months under your government, we will know later. We will know later. So do not say that in 9 months we are clean. Do not make such points where you spoke of the double duck. Cricketing records. This is a great thing. But remember, one of the biggest cricketing records for which Sachin Tendulkar will remain on the record book. Others may be broken. But one record for which he'll remain is the maximum number of times you get out in your 90s without scoring a century. Don't aim to the without scoring your century, you get out. So that is he was talking about cricketing records. I'm saying you are aiming at that record. You'll never complete. And that is why I say this is that all the issues that the Honorable Leader of the House has said, let me not go into it, otherwise you are very anxious to ring the bell when I speak. So therefore I do not want to take a
part. Not only the newspaper.
We will not ring anymore.
It's applicable to everybody.
The point at issue is spoken of the assembly elections and the victories they had except in Delhi. Now, sir, please examine them properly. Even please, the subject is not tutu maima here of who won, who lost. Examine the victories that you had. Why? You floated on the anti-incumbency wave of a non-BJP government there. And that is, and with a divided opposition. Nowhere have you made a formed government, including at the center, with a majority vote. You are in government today with 30% of the vote of those who actually went to poll. It is not a majority government. 69% voted against you. But it's because of the situation where riding on anti-incumbency, you won those elections. And here the anti-incumbency was against the central government in Delhi. And then very proudly you were saying, I mean, of course, humiliating us in the opposition, that the whole opposition can travel in a bus. Somebody quipped in Delhi, the whole opposition of the BJP can now travel in an auto rickshaw. We are reduced to three. So please do not discount the democratic verdict of the people. Why things have happened, please analyze them properly. It's only for the good of the country. Again, I'm saying it's not tutu maima, who wins, who loses. It is for the good of the country. So please understand, either incumbency or a divided opposition, these were the two factors. When they don't happen, there's no victory. And not only no victory, there's a big landslide loss. So that's why, sir, what I'm here saying is, correctly, the Leader of the House said, his dispute on talking about Jammu and Kashmir, that history will decide. Fine, let history decide who is right, who is wrong. I am talking of the history that is being made today. And what is the history that is being made? Every year we stand up to speak, moving on the motion of thanks to the Honorable President of India. This annual exercise is supposed to be a balance sheet of what the government has done and what it will do for the next year. Now we have a peculiar situation, sir. I don't know with your long experience if you had such a situation, where instead of a balance sheet, what the government wants to do keeps changing every year, sir. Last president's address, what they promised or what they'll do, there's no mention of those things here. The Honorable Leader of the Opposition has mentioned all of them. He's mentioned all the name of the name changes that have occurred for the old schemes. They've come in new names. Fine. Our critique of them was everything was concentrated on the Nehru-Gandhi family. Here you'll have Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's and Deen Dayal Upadhyay's and the schemes on their names. They have their set of names for having the schemes. They had their set of names. But the point is, what is the net result for the people of the country? What is the net result for the people of the country? If you follow the left, you will be left behind, is what the Honorable Leader of the House said. He is the one who said, quoting Margaret Thatcher, and in fact not quoting him, but actually taking over what she said, it's not the business of the government to be in business. Then why are you exempting all the increasing list of exemptions? It's not your business to be in business. So let the business take care of it. Why are you doing all this? For the business. That is the point, sir. Why are you doing it again for the business? If it's not the business of the government to be in business, why are you doing that? That is where you're promoting their interests. Very clear. Private educational institutions, exemption. Private hospitals, exemption.
No, please. Javadekar. Javadekar, please.
Irrigation. करवाने के लिए कानून बनाइए ना अब उसके बारे में सोचेंगे नहीं प्राइवेट कौन करेगा सिर्फ मुनाफा बनाना है क्या प्राइवेट इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट के लिए हाँ तो अब आप मान लीजिए वो लॉजिक और वो उसूल और सरकार चलाइए उस हिसाब से तो अब सर इस तरीके की बातों से अब ये जा नहीं लेकिन वो स्कीम्स का नाम नए नए नाम देना या वो स्कीम्स के लिए पुराने स्कीम्स को वो नए नाम बदल कर मतलब उसी को पेश करना ओल्ड वाइन्स एंड न्यू बॉटल्स और न्यू वाइन्स एंड ओल्ड बॉटल्स दैट डजंट रियली हेल्प द पीपल ऑफ आर कंट्री व्हाट इज द करेंट हिस्ट्री दैट इज बीइंग मेड एंड इट इज ऑन दैट वी आई वांट टू ड्रॉ योर अटेंशन एंड द हाउसेज अटेंशन दैट देयर इज समथिंग वेरी ड्रास्टिकली रॉन्ग इन द मैनर इन विच दिस गवर्नमेंट हैज बिगन एम्बार्किंग on this course of taking up the people's agenda. You have talked about the first 25 paragraphs of the Honorable President's speech, talk about the culture, the heritage of India. And who are the people you mentioned? Very good. If they have said such things, they were good. I mean, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee or Deen Dayal Upadhyay. But there is no mention, sir, of the historical rich legacy that we have inherited. The legacy that comes down from Gautam Buddha, Mahavir Jain, from the Upanishads, from all the places and shrines that you all go to. Many, many people.
Javadekar, please. Javadekar, no, sir, not interrupt. Let him.
Sir, fir wahi.
Let him.
Sorry, Javadekar sahab.
Please.
Fir wahi tutu mehme mein utar rahe. Wo kya kiya, hum kya kiya. Arre, desh ke logon ke baare mein soncho na. Wohi hamari agrah hai.
Suniye. Please listen.
Aaj.
No, please cross.
Waja Mohiuddin Chishti ke dargiye par.
Please silence.
Bhai, aap mein se bhi gaye honge. हम भी जाते अब मदर टेरेसा जो है वो कन्वर्शन कर रही है कई लोग बोले इसके बारे में चर्चा भी हुई जीरो आवर के अंदर अब ये सब सुनिए
Yes, yes.
No, in any case, the
minister. The minister is chewing gums and running commentaries in the house. That is against the decorum of the house.
The leaders in opposition are speaking.
Please.
The leader of the house was heard with respect. Therefore, please give the same respect to the leaders in the opposition also. And the ministers, if they interrupt, that's a reflection on the government.
Ministers should not interrupt. Nobody should interrupt. Nobody should interrupt. And especially ministers. Okay, please.
Sir, that is precisely the point.
Let us hear in silence.
My point is this government has one agenda for public consumption and one real agenda on which it's actually working. The agenda for public consumption, what it is doing to the state of people as far as the economy is concerned, I'll come to in the later half of my speech. But what is the real agenda that is being pursued, sir? You had this entire love jihads and you had Ghar Wapasis and you have all these statements that are made every day, continued to be made on the question of the glory of the Hindu civilization and Hindus alone are the inheritors of this legacy in our country. I mean, nothing can be farther away from the truth, sir. And I've said this before in the house and I tell you, even today, if you go by that biopic vision, India as we know of it cannot remain. And we said the Prime Minister himself, what were we asking him last time here? Will you take action against your members of parliament and ministers who are making such comments that are inflaming communal passions, which is against our constitution, against our IPC? No assurance? The Honorable Prime Minister goes to some function of a Christian group and then he preaches tolerance. Very good. But what we promise to our citizens in the Constitution of India is not only tolerance. We promise equality. Not a mention of the word that people belonging to other non-Hindu religions will be treated as equal. And that is the real agenda that is being pursued, sir. And that is not in the interest of the future of our country, my country, and our glory. So all that is being done today is a negation of that syncretic civilization that evolved and continues to evolve on these lands. And this is something which is a very serious issue that is coming up before us. The controversy over Nobel laureate Amartya Sen, the controversy over Mother Teresa, Nobel laureate Bharat Ratna, and these controversies on the question of this betrays a certain lack of commitment to democracy. I'm sorry to say this, but it is an unfortunate situation where the central government of the day encourages or protects those who are violating our constitution provisions with impunity. And you have these people who are going around today who keep talking of only Hindu and Hindus as the only inheritor of this civilization. If you want, I can read out the speeches of the chief of the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh when he said about Mother Teresa, what does he say? Quote, it is good to work for a cause with selfless intentions, but Mother Teresa's work had ulterior motive, which was to convert the person who is being served to Christianity. And then he says on another occasion, Hindustan is a Hindu Rashtra, which is a fact. We are going ahead with this idea. All Hindus have to be organized to make this nation great, unquote. Please organize your Hindus if you want. But the point is what? I am also a Hindu, who born a Hindu but turned into being a Nastic and a communist, Who is a Hindu according to you? And if you
Nastik, you are also placed in Hinduism.
Precisely.
Yeah.
And it is as ancient. It is as ancient. I have quoted this earlier to you. Please show some, at least what the Prime Minister preached to all of the country, tolerance. Please show some tolerance. If not granting equality, show some tolerance.
Please listen to this speech. When your chance comes, you can reply. Please listen to.
Yeah. Being in government does not give you the prerogative to be the only ones to speak. So you allow the others to speak and say their point of view. You may completely disagree. Finally, the people will decide who's right, who's wrong. But please do not go on interrupting this. And the same way the RSS chief continues saying, this is a favorable time for the Sangh. Unquote. So what is happening today is the unleashing of the unsaid agenda, which is palpable amongst the people. I'm not going to the issues of J&K, etc., on which we can debate. We have a point of view. But the question is, there's no time to go into all this. But then, what is the political aim of this? Earlier they used to charge today's opposition as saying that the government is being run by a remote control from Tanjanpat. And today, the former president of the BJP, currently the Home Minister, he says that there is no question of any remote control. We are the same. What does he say? I quote what he said at the Hindustan Times Leadership Summit. Quote, RSS is not an external force. I am from the RSS. The Prime Minister himself is a RSS volunteer. We are RSS members from childhood and will remain till we are alive. Clearly, this is an RSS government, unquote. Now the point is, you may claim to me that he is right, absolutely, could be right. Don't claim this dichotomy between fringe elements and the core. There is no such dichotomy. What even my friends in the opposition are talking, there is no such thing as the fringe and the core. The fringe.
Okay. Now please. Baithiye. Rangarajan baithiye. Are Nibanth. Bas. Now please.
Sir.
Now Rashtrapati. Rashtrapati baithiye. Baithiye Rashtrapati. Rashtrapati baithiye. Rashtrapati please take your seat.
Sir, I need your protection. Can I get it?
No, silence please. Rashtrapati baithiye please. Yeah. Please proceed.
So that is
please
why I'll come to the agenda for the people. The president of the BJP himself says, "Ye sab chunavi jhumle hai." The promises made during elections are chunavi jhumle. And 56-inch ki sarkar, chhati ki sarkar, has now taking recourse of saying, "Ye sab jhumle hai." Ab ye jhumlon ki sarkar ke baare mein aaunga. Ab abhi bataunga kya kar rahe hai, kya nahi kar rahe. Kahi saare baate kiye sir. 27 में प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया कहते हैं कि काला धन को वापस लाएगी हमारी सरकार प्रतिबद्ध है. क्या हुआ काला धन को? वो सब जुमले हैं. नहीं वो 100 दिन के अंदर की बात छोड़ो, वो सब जुमले हैं. अब वो कुछ वापस तो आना तो है नहीं. ये सब जुमले थे, चुनावी जुमले. हमारे आंध्र प्रदेश के बारे में रीऑर्गेनाइजेशन बिल के जो प्रोविजन है उसको लागू करने की बात कही. क्या हो गया? चुनाव जीत के सरकार में आ गए और कुछ नहीं. अब उल्टा हो रहा हो. जुमले क्या सर? इसके बाद में तो बाद में आएंगे. लेकिन अब एक्चुअली सवाल क्या है?
प्लीज
व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इन आवर कंट्री इज द वर्स्ट फॉर्म ऑफ वोट बैंक पॉलिटिक्स दैट इज बीइंग प्लेड. कंसोलिडेट द मेजोरिटी वोट बैंक हाउ? बाय स्प्रेडिंग हेट्रेड अगेंस्ट द माइनॉरिटीज. एंड दिस इज द डेंजरस पार्ट. स्प्रेडिंग हेट्रेड अगेंस्ट द माइनॉरिटीज विच द होल वर्ल्ड इज नोटिसिंग. Not only we, our friend Barak, as we've heard. Barak.
Your friend?
Barak.
Is your
Barak,
friend?
Barak. No, our friend. Friend. Our friend. The Prime Minister's friend. Barak has mentioned twice about this matter. Once he was said that no, he was misunderstood. Nothing like a parting shot. Then he goes back and he says no parting shot, but the White House issues the next day another speech of his saying the same thing. So please understand, the world is watching, people of India are suffering. So this real agenda of yours that you are implementing today, you rein that in. That is not in the interest of our country and the idea of India as we know of it. Yes, I know. You are once upon a time, Sarsingh Chalak, Golwalkar has said there are three internal enemies that are preventing RSS from going into forming the Hindu Rashtra. And who are they, sir? I don't know if you still believe in the faith that you were born in, but they are the Muslims, the Christians and the communists. Now this is what internal enemies that need to be eliminated, otherwise they can't achieve their purpose. With such hatred, are they talking about glory of the Indian civilization or just the Hindu civilization? And what was the glory of this Indian civilization? We've got our wisdom down the ages through the various texts and sages who have taught us. Swami Vivekananda, what does he say? Last time when I quoted him, I was challenged, saying that no, this is not a correct quotation. I hope he is there here, Mr. my friend. Anyway, he's not here at the moment. But now I quote, sir, without the Buddhist revolution, conversion, without the Buddhist revolution, what would have delivered the suffering millions of our lower classes from the violent tyrannies of the influential higher castes? Question mark, unquote, Swami Vivekananda. Volume 4, page 462, if you want, before you put a jar. And then further, what does he say? Mohammedanism came as a message for the masses. In quotes, Mohammedanism came as a message from the masses. The first message was equality. There is one religion, love. No more question of race, color, or anything else, unquote. And then what does he say? What was being a challenge last time when I quoted? I quote, I see in my mind's eye the future perfect India arising out of this chaos and strife, glorious and invincible with Vedanta brain and the Islamic body, unquote. You talk of the glory of the Hindu civilization. You talk of making the Bhagavad Gita the book, a national book. Now, you say, what does the Bhagavad Gita say, sir? Okay, if you want, dare you to reject that. What does the Bhagavad Gita say? I'll give you which shloka. Chapter 7, shloka 21. What does it say? Quote, whatever celestial form of a devotee seeks to worship with faith, I stabilize the faith of that particular devotee in that particular form. Unquote. Disregarding all this, disrespecting all this, brushing aside all this wisdom that has come down and that has kept this country united, I can quote to you what Gurudev Rabindranath said. What Gurudev Rabindranath said, I quote again, Aryans and non-Aryans, Dravidians and Chinese, Scythians, Huns, Patans and Mughals have all merged and lost themselves in one body, and that body is India. Unquote. I mean, what they are doing is anachronism of the worst order. They are trying to put the clock back and take India back into a situation of complete strife and anarchy, which cannot build a prosperous India. Forget building a prosperous India, even what we have today will be further destroyed. So that is why, sir, this particular, the real agenda which they are following. And for that, what do they require? A distortion of science, a distortion of our history. Mythology replaces history. Theology replaces philosophy. The Prime Minister says what great plastic surgery inventions India had, otherwise Ganesha, the god which is revered by various people, could not have been created. Ek haathi ka sir kaat ke ek insaan ke sir pe lagaya. An immaculate conception of Karna in the Mahabharata is not only the Christians or Christianity or the Old Testament that talks of the immaculate conception. We've had that from before, from many centuries earlier. People were flying, people were going to Mars. Mangalayam was not a new idea. Mangalayam is something that we used to do centuries ago. Now all this, fine, even if you were, suppose you were doing all that, it's all nonsense, but suppose you were doing all that. If you are doing all that, why are you in this state today? Why is it that today in our Buddhist culture, Buddhist treasures of art, Buddhist philosophy is all to be found in the caves? Why is it not on open ground? Because Buddhists were actually hunted and ostracized from this society and move out of the parameters of this India. Whether it is Bhutan or hence onwards, through Tibet and China, whether it's in Southeast Asia, whether it's in the South in Sri Lanka, whether it's in the West until the Taliban destroyed it, whether it was in the Bamiyan, in the huge statues of Buddhism, except for this part, it thrived all over the world. The message of equality and love, that was destroyed in our country. What do they want today to create is exactly the antithesis of what Swami Vivekananda said in the 1893 speak to the Parliament of Religions. And what did he say finally, sir, in that speech? In that speech he says, and I quote, and there in 11th of September 1893, he concludes his address to the World Religion of Parliaments with these words, quote, "If the Parliament of Religions has shown anything to the world, it is this, that every system has produced men and women of the most exalted character. In fact, in the face of this evidence, if anybody dreams of the exclusive survival of his own religion and the destruction of others, I pity him from the bottom of my heart and point out to him that upon the banner of every religion will soon be written, in spite of resistance, help, not fight, assimilation, not destruction, harmony and peace, and not dissension." 120 years ago he said this, sir, for Vivekananda. Of course, he couldn't have foreseen that there will be something like the RSS here, that will prevent our country from achieving this. But this is what he has said. Now, what I am trying to make this point is, please come out with your open agenda. Don't say development illusions for the people, when the actual pursuit of the agenda is this, that, and this, to put it very pithily, the pursuit of the actual agenda is to transform, metamorphose, to transform a secular democratic Indian republic into their version of a rabidly intolerant fascistic Hindu Rashtra. That is the project, and that agenda is unfolding in the last 9 months. So when people jokingly say, "Nau mahine ke baad kuch paida hota hai," to ye ho raha sir paida? Ya ho chuka hai. Matlab ek aur avatar mein paida ho chuka hai. Ab aisi paristhiti mein, sir, you come to their agenda for the people. While this is something which we cannot allow, and I'm sure nobody in India will allow the splintering of this crucible of human civilization. And that is because of these various religions, various cultures who have come and mingled. And now if you talk of exclusivity, the unity of this country cannot ever be maintained. Our country can remain united only, and I repeat, sir, underline, only when you strengthen the bonds of commonality amongst the diversity that we have. Not by imposing a uniformity on that diversity. And you are imposing a uniformity. And that cannot be allowed, will not be allowed. That is the conviction that I have today. Welcome. Then you look at the president's speech, sir. Paras 44 to 52. It's all about the various promises that were made to the people and the achievements that were made. He talks about Make in India as though it's a great invention. He announced Make in India, and the next week the Nokia production facility in Tamil Nadu closed down, and tens of thousands of our youngsters, 25,000 skilled engineers of my youth, they have been rendered jobless and on the streets. Make in India. The reality is something else from what is the rhetoric. And this reality, sir, if you want to see, that today, you talk about falling inflation. We heard the leader of the opposition today say that we have reduced. I'm leader of the house, sorry. Leader of the house, sorry, I didn't mean you. Leader of the house. He's got so used to it in the last 7 years that it's a matter of habit. I'm sorry, a slippage. He talked about the benefits of the international oil prices falling, being passed on to the people. What is the reality, sir? The reduction in price for the people that has been given during these 9 months is 2 rupees 42 paise per liter of petrol and 2 rupees 25 paise per liter of diesel. But what is the reduction of the costs that have occurred due to international fall in prices? ₹7.75 per litre for petrol and ₹7.50 per litre of diesel. So how much have you given the people? One third? Less than that? Less than one third of the benefit of the fall in the oil prices has gone to the people. And they claim that they have given a lot of benefit to the people. Now this is the obfuscation that is happening. The truth of the matter is otherwise, and that is what you've seen in the Delhi elections reflecting. Now the point is, learn from that and stop only this rhetoric. You talked about Annadatha Sukhino Bhava. In what is it, para 27, I think, of the president's speech. What is the state of affairs in our agricultural sector, sir? We talked to the leader of the house speaking in terms of 60% living off 15% of the GDP. If they come to the, they want to be brought here and create industrialization, give them jobs, very noble idea. But what is the reality that we are seeing here? In the current Rabi season that is going on in Indian agriculture, the cultivated area is reduced by -5.3%. Farmers are abandoning cultivation. 5.3, reduced by 5.3%, cultivated areas, not productivity, not production. Farmers are leaving your land saying that they are no longer productive. Why? Mr. Sushil Atpawar was here in the morning, is not here now. For 3 days in a row, we caught him here when he was in government. For 3 years in a row, the increases in the minimum support price has been less than the increase in the cost of production as estimated by the Agricultural Prices Bureau, not by us. So if you give them a minimum support price that's below the cost of cultivation, they incur debt, and because of incurring the debt, unable to pay it back, they're committing suicides. And after this government has come to power, sir, after this government has come to power, on this December 19, I have the access, is published in media, the Information Bureau, the IB, sent a report to this government, which is marked to also the National Security Advisor and the Principal Secretary. And what does it say? What does it say? Suicides amongst the farmers is increasing. And the reasons? Due to outstanding loans, rising debt, low crop yield, etc.
No, please. No, don't interrupt. There is no time. Please interrupt. Don't interrupt.
Yachuriji?
See. सर अगर आप आईबी में है तो बता दे हमें. अच्छी बात है अगर आपको जानकारी है इस रिपोर्ट का, लेकिन हमें जो जानकारी है जब के आया मैं बता रहा
हूँ.
ये रिपोर्ट का टाइटल है स्पेट ऑफ केसेस ऑफ सुसाइड बाय फार्मर्स अनकोट, एंड इसमें कहा द मेन रीजन इज दैट दे आर द मेन रीजन इज दैट दे आर बोरोइंग फ्रॉम प्राइवेट मनी लेंडर्स एंड दैट इज वाई यू हैव द सुसाइड्स ऑन द राइज. अब कौन से अच्छे दिन किसके लिए है सर? And then you have talked about the REGA. He says this much money has been spent. During the last 9 months, according to your own government's reports, what are the number of people who have been employed under REGA? It fell from 83.7 lakh households to 60.7 lakhs in these 9 months. And today you had the Minister of Finance and the Leader of the House justifying, saying that we spent all the money. But why is there a fall in employment? Now, if I can go on like this, sir, you are now, the government is storm traveling, right, saying that we are the fastest time growing process economy in the world.
What is the money going there?
That they have to answer.
No. And there is no time, you sit down.
Where is the money going?
No, please.
Sir, they have recently changed the base year calculations for economic statistics. And because of the change in the base year what they are showing, the economy has progressed and we are now the largest, fastest growing economy in the world. We have outstripped China. But they didn't realize, ironically. The same change in the base year has also shown the UPA government in the last 2 years in a much better record. So all that election speeches were actually a total rhetoric and based on wrong facts then. Forget that issue. Okay, we are the fastest growing economy in the world, outstripping China. What is the reality, sir? December 2014, our factory output growth...
Now try to conclude. Eh?
Now, how can I, sir, with all the disruptions? Please don't be unfair now. Factory output growth slowed down in December 2014 to 1.7%. 1.7%, the fastest growing economy in the world. Our factory output is 1.7% growth, falling from 3.9% in December last year. Now, where are you and what is happening? In the economy today, the growth is not taking place because the people of our country do not have adequate purchasing power to buy. Whatever little they are earning, either through growing unemployment or price rise, their disposable incomes are reducing. The net result is our economy is not growing because of bottleneck of demand, not bottleneck of supply. This government is going on talking of bottleneck of supply. Foreign investments, domestic investments, make them invest more, we will grow. Who are they to purchase what these investors produce, sir? If the investors invest and produce something, somebody has to be there to purchase them. You can't sell them in the foreign markets because of the global economic crisis and your exports have fallen by 11.7%. Only place you can sell them is in India. And in India, people's purchasing power is reducing, so you can't sell them here. How will the economy grow? How will the economy grow by bringing in greater and greater foreign capital? They'll come here to maximize their profits by exploiting our mineral resources and our labor. What needs to be done? I wish the finance minister was here to hear this. What needs to be done is to take policy measures to expand the purchasing power in the hands of our people. And how can that be done? Not by curtailing public investment or disinvesting public sector, but by increasing your public investments that can generate new jobs, build the much needed infrastructure, and the wages that people get will expand the domestic market. What they're doing is the exact opposite of what is required. All these issues have been raised about coal sector and personally pointed towards me and they said it's not the denationalization. If it's not the denationalization of coal sector, tell me, why have you removed the clause that the end use clause is not important? You can hand over coal mining to private players. And that means they can use the minerals for commercial sale. So what is happening, sir, is that in reality what is happening is entirely different from the process of privatization of the coal sector from the back door. In the name of electricity generation, in the name of fertilizers, etc., four categories you exempted, saying that private mining is allowed. Now you want to extend that further. So you are undermining or cutting the branch on which you are sitting. Kalidasa taught us this long, long ago, this wisdom, that, I mean, what will happen if you cut the branch on which you are sitting, and that is precisely what this government is now aiming at. And therefore, what is being done to the Indian economy, unfortunately, is that contrary to all that they have been saying, the opposite is happening as far as the people are concerned. So the real promises that they have made to the people, ye achhe din aane wale hain, I'm concluding, ye achhe din aane wale hain, ye 26 inch ki chhati, oh, chappan. सॉरी या मेरे नजर गलती हो गई या नहीं अब उतर गई 26 पे वही मैं कह रहा हूँ अब 56 इंच की
नो प्लीज
ये 56 इंच की सरकार ये सब सर व्हाट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ दिस टू द एक्चुअल यूथ ऑफ अवर कंट्री व्हेन वी टॉक ऑफ क्रिएटिंग ए बेटर इंडिया अनफॉर्चुनेटली आई नो द कंस्ट्रेंट्स ऑफ द ऑनरेबल प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया ही कैन ओनली गिव रीड आउट व्हाट द कैबिनेट अप्रूव्स. And he's probably read out what the cabinet has approved. And each speech of the President of India, I hope, doesn't turn out to be a mini election campaign, manifesto. what is written last year is totally ignored this year. This year you made a string of promises. Now what will happen to them, we don't know. But the net result of all this is the actual conditions of the people are worsened. The actual conditions of the people are worsening, and you have this forked tongue operation that is happening. With one tongue speak of the rhetoric of development, which is not being realized, and the other tongue is the real tongue that is wagging. And that is where I think there is a very serious problem of the vision that has been sought to be portrayed, that we will build a better India. Finally, sir, the question of your foreign policy and India's standing in the world. You talked of good relations with the neighbors. What is the policy towards Kashmir? Are we going to talk? Or towards Pakistan, are we going to talk or not talk? Are the talks going to take place or not take place? We will answer. We are talking of a strong government. We are talking of a strong government. Minister of External Affairs has said, this is a strong government which cannot be ignored in the world. And we were hearing the accusation against a former Prime Minister who said, in the country he is Mount Mohan Singh. Abroad he speaks, but not in the country. And now, in the 9 months, our Prime Minister has travelled much more than I think he has done in about 4 years. And there are some which are left out, some countries, and he is doing that, either during the session or immediately soon after. Fine, you go all over the world, try to build up your equation. But the question is our foreign policy an independent policy, or are we succumbing step by step towards what is happening, to becoming a subordinate ally of US imperialism? The reason I say this is what is happening in civil nuclear arrangement. They talk of an arrangement. And in this arrangement is what? That the supplier will not be liable. 2 minutes, I feel. The supplier will not be liable. That there will be an insurance policy taken out by who? By a public sector insurance companies, not the private. Where the government owns the equity. The public sector insurance companies, along which will be matched by the government, and that will be the corpus from which compensation will be given, but the supplier will not be held responsible at all. This is complete violation of the law we pass. And this is total surrender to American, the interests of the American corporates, which is being paraded as something done with the national objective in mind, etc. So with the neighbors, we do not know what is happening. With the USA and the world, we do not know what is happening. I'm ending, sir. I told you, you won't feel comfortable till you press the bell, and I won't be comfortable to end without hearing the bell. So therefore, sir, in sum, this is neither a balance sheet of the last 9 months, nor a vision for the future, except promises of elections rhetoric. Last time, 9 months ago, on this very occasion of in the motion for thanks, I remember concluding saying that this government neither has given a blueprint of what it wants to do, nor a 100 days target, nor a thousand days target, and now there are no targets to measure what they have done. New targets and slogans have been given. So this sort of rhetorical government functioning is not in the interest of either country, and worse, it is against the interests of our people. So therefore, sir, I would sincerely urge the Honourable President, we have moved, sir, amendments. I would sincerely urge the government to consider some of these amendments, not because you will lose and we will win. That's not the attitude. The attitude is, are we going to create a better India or not? Are we going to say that everybody in my country, irrespective of which religion he belongs to, or an atheist that he is, that they will find equality, not a benevolent charity of tolerance? You can be charitable and give tolerance. That is not what is promised in the modern Indian Republic. What is promised is equality. Are you giving this equality to all citizens, irrespective of their religious affiliations? My submission is no. It's getting worse, and this needs to be corrected. And if, unfortunately, government doesn't heed our point of view or opinion, okay, then the people will have to teach them a lesson whenever the opportunity will come.
Okay.
And therefore, sir, through you, I request the government to seriously consider, considering some of these issues and make the necessary corrections in the interest of the country and the people. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.